Hi, everyone. We're going to start now. I just want to introduce ourselves. My name is Mei Tao, and I am a BPSO coordinator at Toronto Public Health. We implemented about 10 best practice guidelines in our unit, and I co-lead with Dan Nagel last year on this new to publishing group. And I actually have a wonderful learning opportunity or learning time with him. So I encourage everybody, after listening to this information session, signed up for January. So here's Dan.
Hello there. And if you can't hear us or if you have any questions, please let us know. We're presenting on the proposed new to publishing group, but certainly we invite any questions that you might have. So my name is Dan Nagel. I'm a PhD candidate at the University of Ottawa, but I'm now also an assistant professor at St. Francis Xavier University in Nova Scotia. And my background has been primarily community health, although I've been in education in the last 8-9 years in a teaching role. And during the course of my PhD studies, I have been very actively writing. I think I've first authored 4 articles, and I've got 2 more coming out, and feel very passionate about developing writing skills for my students and for anybody else who really is interested in learning how to write. And so what we're doing today is presenting a bit of an information session on what our proposed new to publishing program will be starting in January. And it is modeled on 2 groups that we just had over the last year, which supported a number of individuals, grad students and BPSO people all over the place. And so we're really pleased to be able to talk to you about the session and hopefully invite everybody along for the journey in starting in January. Okay, so I'm just going to turn it over to May, and she's going to talk about the goals for the new to publishing group.
So the goal is, there's about 4 of them. The first one is to provide you some support in submitting a manuscript for publication. We also want to let you understand what the key steps in writing of a manuscript. And then hopefully by the end of the sessions, or like in between the sessions, that you would develop an action plan to submit the manuscript. And also, if you are already writing a manuscript, then you will be finishing writing this manuscript by the end of the session. And it will be facilitated as a sustainable, peer-driven, ongoing publication group. So during the 6th session that we're going to have, if you have topics that you want to, ask to discuss, we will be actually doing that as well. Or, at the end of the session, you might want to actually have a community of practice group together.
And one of the things is that we're really interested in developing capacity for writing. And so there are going to be people at various comfort levels with writing, and certainly different levels of experience. And so in terms of being a peer-driven group, we really value everybody's input. And for people who do come on with a little bit of writing experience, to share some of their ideas and thoughts. And one of the things that we have really learned from the groups that we've worked with is that everybody comes with different experiences in the writing trajectory. Some people have may not have first authored a paper, but they might have participated in writing and can speak to, working in groups and so forth. The other thing, too, that even though, the ideal might be to have a publication, the reality is when we start from scratch in writing any kind of an article, and it doesn't have to be a peer-reviewed article, it could be it could be a conference abstract, it could be a number of things, is that it does take time to develop. And we cannot stress enough that the time it takes for the initial planning to get this together and to actually pull it all together to a state that's ready for publication. And there's a lot of steps to think about along that journey. So our whole goal here is to really support in that navigation. And we also know that a lot of people who we've worked with, because there was a group that we had before New to Publishing last year called It's Time to Publish, that people find ways to craft teams, to work, you know, with other people. If you're from an organization, you might be able to find somebody from the academic side of the house to collaborate with and so forth. And so we really do support those kind of activities. So any questions about the goals thus far? So in terms of the criteria for being part of the New to Publishing group, the primary criteria is having an interest in writing a manuscript as a first author. And some of you may already know that you're going to be a first author. Depending on your organization, you may have already volunteered or been approached for that. And the thing that we will say is that if you are going to be a first author, we will welcome you to bring on board maybe a co-author that you're working with. Whoever signs on as the first author will be the primary contact. But part of our idea, and it did work out in a few of our other groups, is that it's a much stronger thing if you're able to work in a team. And if you have somebody who can be an alternate to attend a meeting because you're not able to, or because two heads are better than one, we will encourage that if you have a co-writer, to have that person attend the sessions as well. One of the things that we're proposing is six sessions, and so ideally we'd like to have people that will be able to commit to 75% of the sessions. We do know that life gets in the way. Through our novice approach, we actually put our meetings on Mondays and Fridays, which typically don't work very well for long weekends and other various reasons. So we've learned that a bit of the planning is trying to find a better time of the week. But we also know that during the winter there can be blizzards like we had last year and these kind of things. Life happens, and certainly there can be work obligation and shifts in that part as well. So we understand that. But the ideal is that hopefully whoever comes on board will attend 75% of the sessions. And the other criteria, and this is where there's a bit of lead time here, and another reason why we're doing this information session, is that ideally whoever comes on board will either have a paper in progress or have an idea for a paper. We expect that there will be people who are graduate students, BPS organizations and representatives, and so people will have different things to focus on writing and so forth. If you're a BPSO, and we'll cover this a little bit later, you will, by virtue of signing up as a pre-designate or a designate, have some obligations to produce some kind of manuscripts. In graduate studies, you, especially if you're doing PhD, you're likely to be required to produce publications as part of your grad studies. So you can certainly develop any kind of a paper from those areas. So going back to something I mentioned a little bit earlier is that in thinking about publishing, even if you were doing this on your own and not being part of our sessions, is to try and build some sense of capacity. It is sometimes very difficult to write on one's own, especially if you have not had that experience before. And so usually having more than one author, and depending on your organization, there may be an expectation that a nurse manager or some other champion or somebody is going to be part of your paper writing experience. So one of the things, in, besides thinking of a topic or having a paper in mind, is actually thinking about who you'd want to have as part of your writing team. There is some logistics, and we'll talk about that in our first sessions when you are building a team. But if you know who you want in advance, there's a little bit of negotiation that goes on about how authorship will be shared. Sometimes this can be negotiated in front, but it is one of those things that can become a bit of a sticky point later on in the process if there's at least not an understanding that this has to be negotiated. In terms of building capacity and putting a team together, the one thing that I would really recommend that you do is that if your organization is big enough to have its own librarian, or if you have access to a librarian in a health science center or something, is that right away think about having that person as part of your writing team, and they are going to be an incredible source of information for doing literature searches and even formatting and things like that. They can bring a wealth of knowledge. And typically what we do is that if we invite librarians on board, they usually become one of the co-authors as well, because they can invest a lot of time in this, and they also know how to produce shortcuts and finding things for us as writers. So they are huge. The other potential is that if, in fact, you know of a researcher and the new Nursing Best Practice Research Center has got certain academic professors and researchers who have areas of interest that might fit with yours, try and see if you can find somebody who is an academic partner, because they can also bring additional resources and maybe even experience in writing to your particular group. And when it comes down to trying to refine our writing or coming up with ideas that need to be included or editing, it's always good to have, you know, another set of eyes to work with. So these are things to think about if you're going to build the capacity for writing a publication. And the other thing, and we know that from the RNAO side that they have been in touch with the people who've signed on the dotted line for BPSOs, done the contract work, is to have a champion, whether it's a manager or somebody else that can really support your participation in the sessions. And you actually do require that if BPSOs particularly are going to be successful at meeting their obligations for the contract and getting publications out. Publications take time, they take effort, and they require some resources. And so one of the things that is very helpful in advance for writing and even being part of our session is making sure that you get that support from whomever your champion is. And that brings us to the last part, is around negotiating time for learning and writing. We do a survey at the very end of our sessions, and last year, a number of people, they weren't able to get on top of what they needed to do, even to meet their obligations for BPSO status or even for graduate studies, because they didn't have the time set aside to actually learn about the process, and that meant attending the sessions, but then for the actual writing and the work that goes into that. One of the things that was recommended by a couple individuals is that when they started building in time to attend the sessions, they actually negotiated with their management structure or their champions to have that morning set aside so that they could do some work on the publication and that they could then attend uninterrupted. Now, we do know that the reality of working, especially on the front lines for most of the healthcare services, that isn't always possible, and there are always shifting priorities, and we know that. And so, you know, at the end of the day, we're trying to facilitate the best support and the best success.
Yeah.
So any questions thus far? I'll turn over to May if there's no other questions. She'll talk about the format of the session.
So our format of the session is?
Oh, I better read that. Right. Teamwork.
That's right. So we will use the webinar sessions like just like this and teleconference as well with the phone. The session usually 1.5 hour sessions, and we meet every month together. We begin usually with a quick check-in for the participant and to update what have they done in the month, and also what are they going to do in the before the next session. Usually the format is usually we share some information first, and then we open up for people to actually talk about their experience in writing that far, or people with questions that how do they solve it. So it's pretty much a peer-driven time, but we do share some a topic of the month about the publications. But we actually have leeway if that's a burning question, we will actually delve with it as a group in that particular session. Okay.
And so some of the pre-canned session topics that we propose, and partly this has been driven by our previous sessions and our participants in the previous sessions, is that after the introductory, the very first session, we start talking about how to choose the topic and the journal. Because there's actually quite a bit of work that goes into focusing the topic, selecting who the audience will be, and then figuring out how best to market that article. And when we say journal, we actually talk about target sources, because it doesn't always have to be a peer-reviewed journal that people need to aim for. We have a number of professional magazines, so RNAO has one, CNA has one, that it might be very appropriate to submit an article through them, or some other written piece, because it might be a letter to the editor, or it might be an opinion piece, or it might be something else. It may be a conference abstract that sets up for a good paper, or for an oral presentation at a conference. And one of the things that we will suggest right off the bat is for those that are BPSOs and even for grad students, mm-hmm. you often want the experience of presenting your information. Whenever you do a conference presentation, you probably have a paper that can be written. So we talk about how do we streamline the work that we do, and that is, if I know that I'm going to submit an abstract for a presentation or a poster, I'm doing a fair amount of work for that, so I harvest that work, and there's a way to turn it into a paper. Conversely, mm-hmm. I just presented 3 oral presentations at one conference. It was quite a fluke, actually, but one of them was purely based on a paper that I had already got published.
Yeah.
And so it was so easy to just take now the paper and turn it into an abstract and an oral presentation. So we really do recommend working very efficiently in that manner. So the other thing that we do is we offer a session where a librarian will come on and just talk about how to do a literature search through the databases. We have found that for people who are grad students and recently finished their baccalaureate, they might have had some exposure to this, but they always find that it's a great review. And then there's some people who may have been away from, you know, using library databases and trying to do literature searches, and it's a great warm-up for that exercise. So we do have a librarian that we invite in, and we'll answer people's questions, but we'll give a quick tutorial on how to go about the literature searches. And then later on, we talk about managing references, because once you start harvesting your sources, we need to have a way of trying to manage that. Yeah. So then we talk about the practicalities of writing and how to structure a manuscript, and then how to get that manuscript prepared for a select journal and so forth. And so each of these, we have structured this in six sessions. So we're looking at going from January till June. Mm-hmm. And if there's interest past that, trying to figure out how to keep a peer writing group going past that point, because we find a lot of people through these sessions just get into the rhythm of starting to pull it together, but it's not quite long enough to actually write an entire manuscript. So, you know, the ideal is, would be nice if everybody could pump out a manuscript at the end, but that's not the, that's not our goal at all. If it works out, that's fine, but we just want to make sure people are supported in that journey. And so the question then is, well, what does that journey look like? And the reality is publications take time. What we've put up on the display right now is what would happen for a BPSO organization. And so they go through a pre-designate period and a designate period. Now, depending on when you came on board, it might be candidacy as opposed to designate, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So it looks different for every organization that has come on, depending on when they've started. But it doesn't really change what the timelines look like. So if, you know, if we focus just on the designate end of it, so an organization that has become a designate, is that we know that at the end of a two-year cycle, there's an expectation to do a conference abstract, and usually to have, submit a manuscript. Well, that planning and writing actually has to go right to the front of the bus, because even if you're doing an implementation paper, or if you're, you know, depending on what it is, that alone takes a period of time to go out. But you need to start thinking about, well, what will that paper look like, and what do I need to put in that paper, and how do I find the resources for that paper? And then there's the actual writing. And really, just as an example, I worked with four co-writers. We're all grounded theorists, researchers, and all of us doing our grad studies. We started in September 2014, coming together with our initial paper with four people. I was the principal writer, but with four people, we got it published on September 15th of this year, a whole year from the time of writing it, submission, to revisions and acceptance.
And the same goes to me as a BPS. I have to submit a paper by the last year of the predestinate. So we started our paper pretty much on, or we actually have an idea on the first year, and the second year is pretty much that we did our research on how to write it and who is going to be involved in writing this. So it takes us a whole year just to actually finish that paper and submit it to the publications. Yeah. And so yeah, you need to plan really, really ahead.
Okay, and we did see some good questions coming up on the side. And so if you do have questions, like seriously, either text them to us in the narrative box there, or even say something. We will answer them, of course. So for Chris, in answer to your questions, the slides, that's the easy one. We'll have Verity send that out to everybody who's participated today. So we will do that. Now, if you have an idea as a BPSO, where is the first place to take the idea for discussion before we start in this group? So my first recommendation would be figure out who your champion is and who it is that you answer to in terms of the signing of the contract, because I think That has to be part of it.
Yeah.
And then the other part of it is, who else is involved in whatever BPG it is that you're working on? And that's where I would start, and that is also where I would look to building the capacity, because your question that you're posing here might be that catalyst for bringing together a group of like-minded people who are interested in it. So that's my idea. Go ahead, Nick.
So I can tell you an example that in our organization, we implemented the postpartum depression best practice guideline. At the beginning, we know that we need to write a paper or go to conferences with that. So what we did is right from get-go, we actually had Dr. Cindy Lee Dennis from U of T to join us as what partners for that particular best practice guideline. So she actually did the research with us together for our support group, and actually that we are going to co-write with her together for the postpartum depression support group that we did our evaluation. So right from the get-go, the first year that we joined as a predestinate, we already have her as our partner. So, yeah.
And that also, I think, goes back to, like, who might you have on the team and where might be this idea for discussion. So if, in fact, you were to find somebody in the research side of the house, in the land of academia at one of the universities or whatever, is that if you can find somebody who shares an interest in this, they might actually help you with developing the idea, and that might be a place to start as well.
Yeah.
So sometimes it's about a little bit about networking, and we did a little matchmaking in a couple of our sessions because we would have grad students working on stuff in one area, and it just happened to be related to the BPG or interest of one of the BPSO. So outside of this group, people were starting to create links.
And the other thing will be is, you know, if you are actually implementing or writing a paper on one BPSO, maybe that BPG is the same BPG that another organization that is similar that is also doing. So you might actually collaborate with them as well. For example, I can tell you that I am collaborating with the Great Bruce Public Health to actually write a paper on about the Advanced Clinical Practice Fellowship, because we, both of us actually are fellows, advanced clinical practice fellow, but also that we mentor them, Great Bruce Public Health. So the paper comes out because of the fellowship that we both involved in too.
Yeah, and as you're saying that, because we're looking at taking up to 20 individuals in this set of sessions. Before we would sign up, about 14, 15, and a lot would disappear just because of work commitments and various reasons. So we're thinking of taking in 20, so I think what we would do in the first session is to do a bit of matchmaking even within, if it works out. If there are some people that are working on the same topic area, there might be a way to create that link. So either you collaborate on writing
the actual manuscript
yeah. or collaborate in sharing resources.
Right.
So, and ideas. So one paper might focus on this and another group might focus on that, but it's still on the same topic.
Right.
Any questions? Any other questions so far?
Did we give you an answer, Chris?
Yes, that was excellent. Thank you.
Okay.
Now, where it says publications take time, and we're looking at this diagram, and it looks, you know, pretty straightforward, there is another thing that we won't share with you in a picture form here, and that is once we submit the manuscript, there are three things that happen. Either it's accepted, or it's accepted with revisions, or sometimes it's rejected. And as writers, seasoned writers, we know what rejection feels like. And so one of the things to always bear in mind is that once we submit a manuscript, there's usually a 2 to 3 month wait before we even get that initial feedback. So when we show on this diagram submit manuscript, that is the finish of the writing and the submission piece. There's another piece that follows that.
That's sort of the end, but also the beginning.
Yeah, and potentially a new beginning.
Right.
So, and it's something that we reinforce along the way, but by doing the upfront work, it sometimes mitigates the turnaround time when it comes to a successful manuscript acceptance. And even if it's a rejection, oftentimes there's feedback that comes. It's just a matter of finding, making the necessary revisions, and then turning it around very quickly to a second journal. So when we start coaching people and trying to pick the target audience and the journal or the source that they're going to submit to, we always say, what is your first, second, and third choice?
Right.
So that you can turn it around fairly quickly.
The other thing that I think now is the turnaround time is every, well, for the destiny, every 2 years you produce a manuscript.
Because
of the destiny.
To ensure they continue to receive important updates and membership information. Please continue to hold. Thank you for your patience. Someone will be with you shortly. Please be sure to visit our website, rnao.ca, for the latest in nursing.
Anybody out there? Can you hear us?
Can you hear us?
Nurse
practitioner. Verity, it's Deb. This happened yesterday as well in a webinar, and if you hit the pound button twice, it'll mute all the lines.
Membership information.
And then
the conference has been muted.
Oh, it's muted.
Can you hear us? Oh, there's something else that happens at the pound button.
Bev?
So what everybody has to do once all the lines are muted, when they want to talk, they just hit *6 and it'll unmute the person's line who wants to talk, and then they need to mute again.
Okay, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
So everybody's on mute now, and if you'd like to unmute to say something, please press *6.
Okay. So what I was trying to tell you that is that every 2 years as a decennate, a new decennate, we need to submit a manuscript. So just don't plan just one submission now. Yes, every 2 years you have to submit, but you do need to think about long term, which because 2 years come very fast. So you might actually want to submit, have an idea for this 2 years, but also have another couple ideas for the next submission after the 2 years, because life happens. So if you actually have that plan ahead, then the people that are writing, you know, instead of just get 2 years on the road, they will actually have 4 years. So for me, for our organization, we actually have a submission ready for this year, this term, for the contract. But we also have two other submissions on the go already. So if every year we submit, like every 2 years we submit one, I'm actually working on the third contract. So 6 years from now, I would actually still have a submission to submit. But that comes from experience, I guess. Yeah.
Any other questions at this point? So the last big component, if I can get my
evaluation. It's evaluation, and this is how we propose. So in the interest of best practice, we always have to evaluate anything that we do. So this is actually a proposal to propose how we evaluate the new publication group. We want to capture the monthly attendance. We also want to see, to capture the goal and progress for the participant. We will give you an online survey to complete by the end of the 6 sessions. And also, we like to capture number of plans that you gave us to have, either by verbally or like actually by actual action plan you gave us. And of course, we're delighted if actually you submit a publication by the end of the 6th month. So we will want to capture that as well. Anything you add?
No, that's pretty much it. And yeah, so the proposed evaluation that we do, we've done that with all three groups. we've had. And we're thinking probably at the end of it, we're going to have another publication to write.
That's right.
Because we'll have a lot to go on.
Yeah.
But this is going to be a sponsored event through the Nursing Best Practice Research Center. And so what that is a collaboration between RNAO and the University of Ottawa. And the sessions are meant for NBPRC members. It costs absolutely nothing to join. Some BPSOs are corporate members of NBPRC,
right.
But not everybody is. So what we do is we recommend that people submit a membership request online, and Verity will be able to help people with that because she actually looks after the membership for NBPRC as well. So we're very lucky to have Verity on many fronts here.
Right.
And what we're contemplating doing is knowing that Mondays and Fridays are off the table in terms of when we would offer this, we're looking at offering the sessions on Tuesdays in the month, hoping that will work. We're proposing the second Tuesday of every month starting on January 12th. And that January 12th session would be just fairly much an introductory and just a few beginning points. So that's what we're putting on the table in terms of the day of the week. It's an hour and a half session, and in the past we've run it from 10 until 11:30. So that it, you know, came up against the lunch hour, and so it was, you know, a natural break for most people. But we're quite flexible on the time. So if it works better a little bit earlier for most folks, or right after lunch, you know, we're flexible to do that. But we do need to find a time that's going to work for most people, and we'll probably do a bit of a doodle poll. And right now, while we have you online, any other thoughts that you might have in terms of timing would be great as well. But as we noted before, if you go to your champion, whoever is your manager or whatever, and start thinking about this in advance, at least if we have a more or less concrete day and time, it'll probably be easier for trying to organize. So, any questions, any thoughts? And you'll have to unmute yourself again, so that's star six.
Star six.
Or you can type the question, doesn't matter. Anybody?
Hello?
Help me take the group off mute.
Just a reminder to anybody, if you'd like to say something, that would be helpful. And if you press star six, you can unmute your line.
Hi, it's Teresa from Parkview and Chesley here. We're BPSO pre-designate, so I'm very thankful that you guys are doing this, and I'm looking forward to getting started. Thank you.
Thanks.
And will Tuesdays be okay for you, Teresa?
Yeah, I think Tuesdays will be fine. And as far as the time, like you said, 10 o'clock is fine. After lunch is fine. I'm pretty flexible.
Good.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Hi, this is Leanne Whitney. I'm a member of the Nursing Best Practice Research Unit.
Hi.
Hi, Leanne.
So we have just gone through our BPSO journey, and we've just been newly designated as a BPSO. And one of the things that was suggested to us by Irma Jean was that we start looking at the journals that we're thinking of publishing to very early in the journey. And so I'm just hoping that can be built into your agenda, or our agenda, I guess, as we move forward, as to how you even pick journals and et cetera.
Yeah.
What what that really means.
Yeah, and so we actually have a pretty handy-dandy little flow circle, is kind of what we call it.
Yeah.
And because it's like a chicken-egg thing, right? So you have to have a topic, you have to have who your audience is, and then where does your audience get that information? And so as you're writing, sometimes that changes, and so even though it's ideal to know exactly where you'd like to aim for, once you've done your product, it might not be quite the fit, so it becomes fluid, but at least if you know where you might like to go, that's helpful. And so we do write from the very, from I think the very first session.
First session, yeah.
And we reemphasize it periodically throughout. That is one of the first things that we will look at.
That's right. Picking journal is actually one of the first steps. And you don't just pick one journal, you do pick a few journals because it will lead, you know, if you actually get rejected at the end of it, at least you have, as we say before, you have another second or third journal to actually get your manuscript, to submit the manuscript to.
So even before the session started in January, you can start thinking about prospective journals if you know what you're going to be writing about and just want to check it out. The other thing that happens during the course of sharing is that people have ideas for journals or other target sources that we wouldn't be aware of. And so there's a lot of sharing of that as we go along.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's literally hundreds of journals out there.
Mm-hmm.
And the other thing to be careful of is there are predator journals out there as well. And so you don't want to get caught up where somebody's scooping your article and there's actually no peer review and little circulation as well. So we will certainly speak to that.
Yeah.
That's great. Thank you very much.
Anybody else?
Hello, this is Kim from the Scarborough Hospital.
Hi, Kim.
Hi. Thank you so much for your presentation. This has actually been quite eye-opening for me as I am new to publishing. The question that I have is, you mentioned, you know, coming to these sessions with an idea for what you might want to write about. Is there any focus in the sessions around like how to refine your idea, what can you write about that sort of will distinguish you or separate you from others? You know, so you've got something that's an interesting, a compelling topic that people will actually want to read about.
So actually, one of our half of an entire session ended up being on refining the topic and the focus, because sometimes that is a very difficult thing to do. And it's hard to do until you have an initial idea and then start looking at the literature to see what has been written, what has not. When you can find a gap,
mm-hmm.
then that is the bestest thing in the world, because if it's something that few other people have ever written about, or if you have a new angle on something, then uptake can be pretty good. But it is kind of the chicken egg thing, and so, you know, where do you start? And so you have to start at least with an idea.
Right.
And then
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Yes.
That's actually very, very helpful, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah, and one of the things is, you know, that we've heard so much from people who've been part of the sessions, and that's why we decided to do an introductory session today just as an information session, is honestly, even we had no idea what we were getting into the first time we were trying to write something.
No.
And to be forewarned, forewarned is to be forearmed, and so a lot of people, if they didn't know a lot of this stuff up front and didn't have the support, they would usually quit. And so this is how we start thinking about planning, and if we know that it's going to take time, and even, you know, you might just at the end of the six sessions might just have a brilliant outline ready to go, that's okay, because there's lots to learn, especially if you haven't done this before.
And that's why we warn people that writing manuscripts take time, and you need to start you know, as soon as possible. Waiting, like if you're a predestinate, waiting till the third year to start, it's a little bit rush. So you know, if you want to, you write something, you want to be published. So you cannot rush this kind of process. And if you do, chances of rejection will be huge. You know, your paper will be rejected because you're not preparing enough for it.
And I would suggest to everyone is that when you go to your champion or your managers or whoever it is to negotiate for time, they don't always realize once they've signed the contract with BPSO or whatever that it does take an investment of time. And so this is something to make sure that you convey to them, and that it's really important if they're going to honor the commitments in the contract that they do set aside the time and protect it for you. I mean, we always as professionals have stuff we take home and we work on, you know, on weekends and evenings and off the side of our desk and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
But to do a bang up job and to get the pacing sorted, it really is important to carve time out. And even though we're doing a session a month and, you know, you might want to take that entire morning out to dedicate, you know, if that's not, of course, sufficient if you do that one morning a month, you know, kind of thing. So that's something you have to negotiate with your agency.
Yeah, one of the participants last time was telling us that had she known this process, she would negotiate with her organization to have the session with us in the morning, because then she'll learn things from that session and then actually have the time in the afternoon just to cut for her writing, because you're just fresh, you know, you just have some fresh idea that you could actually implement it in the afternoon. And so she would actually negotiate with her organization to have that afternoon just for her writing for her manuscript.
And for some of us, I know it sounds really nerdy, but it almost becomes, writing becomes addictive.
Yes.
And
once you have one published, then you just keep going and keep going and keep going.
Yeah. And so, but I mean, for other people who find writing hard, it's probably not as addictive, I would suspect. But yeah. And at the end of the day, too, while we're offering these sessions, both Maeve and myself, we're so happy to help people off the grid. I mean, if I found somebody else with my area of interest and wanted to write, you know, I would probably even consider, you know, coming on board in a writing team. My background, as I said before, is community health. For my focus in my dissertation is in the use of telehealth technology. So, you know, that's my area. But I also have a lot of skills in home care, ambulatory care, primary care, because that's my background.
And my area is a systematic review. So I, and guideline strategy, guideline implementation strategies, processes. I can do systematic review very well now. So, yeah, all those areas, yeah. Any other questions?
So if there's no more questions, by all means, get in touch with Verity, and I don't mind my email being circulated for questions if you want to contact us on the side.
Yeah.
And there will be an invitation to actually register for the sessions coming up very soon. We might include a doodle poll just to see what time slot on the Tuesday will work, but right now we're proposing 10 to 11:30. So any final questions out there? Remember, you have to star 6 to talk to us again.
Right.
To unmute, yeah.
Hi, it's Kim from Scarborough. It's just a comment. I just want to thank you very much for this session. It's actually been really helpful. And I'm actually a little embarrassed to say I had no idea what was really involved here. So I'm glad I'm getting this information sooner rather than later in our pre-designation period. So
great.
Thank you very much.
And Kim, you're so close. You're in Toronto, so, you know, you know, if you email me and you want to meet, you know, prior to that, I'll be very pleased to do that.
Oh, I think you're my new best friend now. Thank you.
It is all about networking.
Yeah.
Oh, my golly, that's so great. Thank you so much. I do appreciate that.
And I can also be other people's best friend, too, except we'll have to do it by Skype because I'm in Antigonish, Nova Scotia. So,
thank you.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Anybody else? Hopefully we haven't scared anybody.
No. It's a learning journey, and it is an addicted learning journey.
Oh, and that's the other thing, too, that came out before I forget, because it's that time of the year.
Mm.
If you're thinking continuing competence,
mm-hmm.
this is actually a great exercise
for it.
Yeah.
That's right. And then put it actually in your performance appraisal.
Oh, yeah. That's true.
And so then you can actually have time to do it as well. Because it's in your performance appraisal.
So if there's no other questions, we thank you so much for your time and being part of this, and we will be in contact through Verity very soon.
Thank you.